the sound I love to hear. It's the sound of the Savior's robe as he walks into the room where people pray. When we hear praises, he hears faith. There is a sound I love to hear. It's the sound of the Savior's robe as he walks into the room where people pray. When we hear worship, he hears faith. Sing his praise aloud. Sing his praise aloud. Oh, wake my soul and sing. Sing his praise aloud. Sing his praise aloud. Sing his praise aloud. Awake my soul and sing. Sing his praise aloud. Sing his praise aloud.
Oh, let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. We your victory, oh let it rise, let praise arise. We'll see you break down every wall, we'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you, the God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high, for all creation cries, God we praise you. Oh, 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 we praise you. Oh, 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 let faith be the song that overcomes the rage. Let faith be the song that calms the storm inside of me. Let it rise. Let praise arise. Let it rise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you, the God of breakthroughs on our side. Creation cries, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh, this is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we pray. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear could not survive when we praise you, the God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high, for all creation cried, God we praise you. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you, the God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high, for all creation cries, God we praise you. Oh,
gotta let it out. I can't hold back my This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living
looks like. Oh, hello. How you doing? You good? Good morning. I don't know if you've had your breakfast yet, but I haven't and I'm absolutely starving. But what we're going to do now instead of that is have a big old dance for J-Dog. And yeah, let's have fun.
Good morning and welcome to Church Online. It's great to have you here with us this Sunday, whether you're watching live or you're going to join us on catch up at some point during the week. We're delighted you're here. We're continuing with our positive MO teaching series. Matt's going to be picking up on that a little bit later. Already getting really good feedback around that. So we want to encourage you to tune in every week because it's going to build and grow in momentum and help you work out how you shift from positive identity into action, how it translates into everyday life, your discipleship, your life at home, your life at work, your life in community, if you're connected with this church family. It's all going to make a big difference. Hope you tuned in a bit earlier as well to our Kids Online service, which are happening every other week. We absolutely love them. We're kind of big kids and we enjoy being a part of that. And the focus today was about being fitted with the shoes of the gospel of peace. And we as a church community are walking out some very new stuff in regard to our vision, which Tana's just going to share about and give you a little moment to have a bit of a take home as well.
Yeah, so we're introducing our vision for Cromer Church Birmingham. And I think if you tuned in to the service last week, you would have heard Dave share really from last year how that vision has been unfolding. So we've put together, well, actually shout out to Trin and Matt for all their work with this. We've been putting together a really lovely, colourful newsletter that we'll be posting out to you. And this really will just help you understand more about our story and understand the why and the what. Now, obviously, there'll be some practical things to consider. And one of the things that we want to encourage you with in this season is to pray for us as a church. And there's an opportunity, actually, on the second page, there's ways for you to get involved. First one is to pray, as I just said. The next one is to give. To give financially, to help support us in finding a much larger premise than we've got at the moment. We love it here at Living Well Centre, but it is too small for us. It's not fit for purpose. And we are actively, as a practical solution, looking for a much bigger premise to house us all. We're all desperate to get together and to worship corporately together, and obviously we still want to do that safely, and we can't do that here. So another way to get involved is to simply to serve, and there's lots of opportunities to get involved in ways to serve, and this will tell you a lot more. So yeah, I think you'll enjoy it, and it's a beautifully illustrated piece of beautiful work. So thanks, Trin, thanks, Matt.
If you're on our database, you'll get one of those already. If you're not and you would like to receive one of these newsletters, we want to encourage you just to email us, and we can send one out to you if you give us a postal address, and it'll just tell some of the story and invite you to get involved. There's a lot involved in the transition process that we're involved in right now. So one of the small things we've changed is just our communications. So if you're going to send us an email, you will do it now to info@cromachurchbirmingham.com. That will get through to us and we can respond to you. Other stuff's changing, legal stuff, website, all those things are in process and will take a little bit of time. But for now, we just want to invite you into a place of worship. Our worship team are going to lead us in some songs. We want to encourage you, whether you're at home, in your kitchen, your lounge, wherever you find yourself, just to be active in your response. So we're going to encourage you to stand. It's what we'd normally do if you were here and gathered with us, just as a response to come into God's presence. And we've introduced two of the Beatitudes over recent weeks. One is, blessed are those who recognise their need for God, the poor in spirit, some of the versions put it, for theirs is the kingdom of God. And the second one we've looked at is also, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. And essentially what it focuses in is to two things, hunger and heart. So as we come into worship, we're essentially saying, let's come to God with hungry hearts. So let's just take a moment to pray, and our worship team will lead us into a time of worship. Lord, we just acknowledge your presence. We thank you, Lord, that you will give the kingdom of heaven to those who recognize their need for you. And this posture of open hands and open hearts is simply saying, we need you. We need your presence in our world, in our lives, in our families, in our community, every day, every moment of every day. So we just say, come, Holy Spirit, as we offer our lives to you in this place of worship, would you meet us? Would you fill us with your Holy Spirit? Would you fill this worship time with a sense of incense rising before your throne? And we just pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
The whole earth shakes. see what you can do. God, wonder, your power has no end. The things you've done before, in greater measure, you will do again. 'Cause there's no prison wall you can't break through, no mountain you can't move. All things are possible, and there's no broken body you can raise, no soul that you can save. All things are possible. The darkest night, you
praise.
Just as we come out of this time of worshipping Jesus, just want us to think a moment about your expectancy levels for God. What will your expectancy for God activate as we have spent time in God's presence? The word is filled with God's delight in making us exceedingly great and precious promises, and God adores being our faithful promise keeper. So we're going to calibrate our hearts and set our internal atmosphere for believing God's promises. Just reading from 1 Corinthians 1, 1 to 3. For you have been made pure, set apart in the Anointed One, Jesus. And God has invited you to be his devoted and holy people. And not only you, but everyone, everywhere who calls on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ as their Lord and ours also. May joyous grace and endless peace be yours continually from our Father God and from our Lord Jesus, the Anointed One. I love this verse. So let's set our internal atmosphere in just declaring some truth in this moment and just releasing hope into our atmosphere. We as a community of God, we the church, we are a summoned people called to assemble an army. We have been made pure, set apart in the Anointed One. We have been invited by Jesus to be his devoted and holy people. And let our internal atmosphere be this place of joyous grace and favor and supernatural potency, which leaves us charming and beautiful. Endless peace be yours today, continually from our Father God, our Lord Jesus, anointed one. So we calibrate our hearts and we set our internal atmosphere in this place of worship, declaring the word of God, declaring these beautiful promises. And our encouragement is to be merciful and kind to yourself, as God is so very kind to you. Take time to worship in this stance of peace and rest. And then think about what you are thankful for. Think about what is going on in your lives. Not all the difficult things. We've all got difficult things going on in our world. But what is the beautiful things, the charming things that are going on around us? Set your internal atmosphere by using some of these things. I bless you today in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning and welcome back to our Positive MO series. Before I start, I just want to take a moment to thank David for his talk last week, all around our vision updates, a bit of a family update about where we're going, where we've been, a sort of journey moment. It was beautifully, beautifully delivered, and you could feel the heart. You could see the excitement on his face whilst he was talking. So just a bit of a shout out to Dave for that. But also a bit of an invitation, if you didn't catch that and you've been journeying with us as a church, even if you're new today, I would encourage you to go back a week, watch that on YouTube, and just get up to date, get excited and get expectant about where we're headed and what we're going to be doing in this next season. Anyway, I am Matt, and this morning I want to stay in the Beatitudes where we've been focusing in Matthew 5, and I want to look at a verse and just open that up for us. So the verse is verse 6, and it reads, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled." So firstly, I want to start with, what does it mean to be hungry? Because as 21st century readers of this text, we have to remember that the people Jesus was talking to back then would know very well, in fact, what being hungry, felt like. Jesus didn't go around preaching to the well-off people at feasts with kings. He didn't do that. He came, and he said this himself, to help the sick. He didn't come to help the healthy. That was a bit of a tongue twister, that was. So he preached in crowds of hungry people. He came for those who knew what it meant to have an unmet need. So the crowd, the people that Jesus was addressing with this, were familiar with that burn that comes with hunger. They were not strangers to that dryness that comes with thirst. Jesus was speaking their language. And that's one of the brilliant things about Jesus, is that no matter what your life experience, no matter your history, no matter what part of our beautiful world timeline you've been placed on, he can speak your language. He is a master communicator. And he so personally knows you that actually it's just easy for him to empathize and know where you're at. And I just love that about him. So Jesus is speaking a relatable language. He is acknowledging a common struggle of the people and connecting that to the Father and to heaven's culture. Another thing Jesus is great at is connecting us to the Father. And that's more along the lines, I think, of what this hunger theme is that he's talking about here. So I'm sure we might all know what it feels like to go a couple of hours without a snack or have dinner an hour or two later than usual. It's definitely an uncomfortable place to be in. But that's not the type of hungry that I think is being asked of us in this statement. On one level, that's because these statements are supernatural, so this is a spiritual hunger rather than a natural. Although I do acknowledge that the walking out of these can be fruitful, or you can see the consequences of those in the physical. On a different level, it's because to be filled with righteousness is way more critical, way more urgent, and way more fulfilling than it is to be filled with a Big Mac. And I would also argue that righteousness is just a bit more healthy. No, I'm kidding, it's way more healthy. The type of hungry I think is being referred to is more than that uncomfortable in-between meals on a long day feeling. I suppose actually another word that you could use to maybe access this meaning a little bit easier would be passion. Blessed are those who have a passion for righteousness, for they will be filled. So that might just make it a little bit more accessible for us well-fed first worlders. So let's look at this passion here and just open that up. So this passion is real. Hunger and thirst are real just as much in the spirit as they are in the physical. It's a real life experience of the real life person. In fact, it's so real that there are people in this world, in our community even, who don't have access to the food that they need to quench those feelings of hunger and thirst in the natural sense. And those consequences of not fulfilling the needs can actually be very detrimental, both mental and physically. So hunger and thirst, if left unaddressed, can actually lead to death, and that's a reality for us in the real world. And I think it's not so different in the spirit. I think we all have a spiritual hunger, whether we know it as that or not, whether we are here today as a long-term church member or as a first-time visitor, actually, I think we all have this desire within us for spirituality. In Ecclesiastes 3:11, it says something similar to that effect. It says, "He has also set eternity in the human heart, yet no one can fathom what God has done from the beginning to end." We are designed in the image of a spiritual, eternal, relational, righteous God. So why wouldn't these things be reflected in our hearts too? We're designed to long for that something in us that is of heaven. That's something in you that is of him. And I've observed often that people meet this need in many different places, and that's often the roots of misled spirituality. But the point is, we all have a hunger. We all have a thirst for spirituality. In fact, Alexander Venter says, at the deepest level, the search for spirituality is the innate human desire for God. And I promise that sounds better when he says it, but you get the point. It's something that we all have. It's something we all relate to because it's part of us by design. This type of passion that's being talked about is also natural. If it's by design, then it must be natural. In fact, it can actually be a sign of health. Be that in an animal or a person, hunger can be a sign of health. If you know me at all, you'll know that I have a passion for animals and keeping any animal I can get my hands on. And between my wife and I, we've had a few live with us over the years. So one of the major red flag signs that you come across when keeping animals is a full food bowl. If you put that food bowl down and it stays full for longer than 5 minutes, you know something's wrong. You just know it, trust me. I'm sure a lot of you can relate to that. In fact, in rabbits, which is one of the animals that we keep, and we've had quite a few of those, they actually always need to be eating. So they're always nibbling on hay or whatever it is. They're always eating something. Otherwise, their digestive systems, they just fail and collapse. They have to always have something readily available to feast on. And for me, that's a lot like our life in Christ. We should always be feasting on more of him. If we want our faith to grow strong and keep on functioning, then we ought to be eating regularly at the table of the Lord. Whether that's worship, whether that's prayer, praise, painting, reading, speaking, or studying the word, it could look a number of ways. And just off the back of that, as an encouragement to any of you thinking, I just can't get on with reading the Bible, I don't remember anything, all those silly thoughts. Bill Johnson said recently, and this kind of hit me, was, I don't remember what I had for breakfast last week, but it still nourished me. So it can be as simple as just getting the Bible into you. Just read it, whether you remember it, whether you don't, whether it impacts you in the moment or whether it impacts you 20 years later, just get it into you because it always nourishes you. Anyway, back to hunger. So hunger can always also be a sign from your body saying, hey, I have some unmet needs here. And if you expect me to go on functioning like you need, you're going to have to meet them. In that way, it's a sign of need. And in order to need something, you must first lack it. So this kind of hunger that we're talking about could be as simple as a moment, much like with the purity beatitude that I spoke about a few weeks ago, just a moment of admitting or declaring, hey, God, I need you for this to work out. I need you in this moment. I need you in every moment. By its nature, this admits to lacking something. So to be hungry is first a step of humility. To be hungry, you must first admit that you do not have something. I admit I am without food, therefore I am hungry for food. That kind of pattern. To fulfill in any part this beatitude, I must admit I do not have righteousness. I do not have that by nature. So I must gain it, therefore, and seek it continuously. And I'm admitting to that lack, and I'm declaring my hunger in that. And just like hunger and thirst in our world, this passion for righteousness can be an intense feeling, all-consuming even once you've got it activated. So I don't know if you've ever been hungry at all. I'm sure you have, but have you ever been so hungry that your thought train just jumps off the tracks and you can't seem to get it back on to the subject at hand? No matter what's happening around you, all you can think of is that feeling of hunger. It's sort of like that Snickers advert that says, you're not you when you're hungry. Although in typical Jesus fashion, this is flipped and is saying the opposite, and it says, you're not you when you're not hungry. You're not you when you're not hungry. Now, I'm not sure how Jesus would have felt about Snickers as a snack. I don't like them myself. But I'd hazard a guess that that slogan wouldn't quite gel with the kingdom living that he promotes. Although Jesus does love to redeem things, and maybe that's pushing the chocolate analogy too far. I'm gonna just scroll down. On a similar note, this type of passion or hunger can actually become painful. I'm not sure I've ever gotten so hungry that I'm in pain, but it does happen. In fact, as a bit of a rule of nature, hunger is often a driving force. So there are countless species of many different animals, from mammals to fish to birds to insects even, that migrate between the seasons of the year in order to find food. The driving force between their movements is hunger, because they want to avoid the pain of being hungry. This passion for God, this spiritual food that we're looking for, should drive us to action. It should motivate us to seek more of God, to move closer to God in any way that we can. But the point is that it's a design feature of our lives as creations of God to be hungry for righteousness, to be hungry for him. It's a real life thing, and Jesus offers a real life solution. It's himself. He gave himself to quench this for us, Jesus's salvation and the gift of his righteousness. So verse 6 of Matthew 5 is calling us, the kingdom citizens, to be hungry and to long for the thing called righteousness. But what is righteousness? The definition is simply, well, I use that word tentatively, to be morally right or justifiable, to be just. And in some translations, actually, it uses the word hunger for justice, to be judged right or to be not guilty. Now, I don't know about you, but I could be hungry all day long quite easily, but to be righteous all day long every day is a very different story, especially when you think about our nature and our history. So if you go right back to Genesis, you look at the fall of mankind and all those things, then it's by our nature, it's inherent in us that we are unjust. But luckily for us, we have just recently celebrated Easter, which reminds us of a beautiful day-to-day truth that Christ came to earth and died for us on the cross. He defeated death and then rose to life again as us. So now we are found righteous through the Son. So the first step towards righteousness is salvation. We need Jesus in our hearts to reach this goal. It cannot be through our own strength nor striving. That's because righteousness is a heart issue, and that's why Paul talks about the breastplate of righteousness in Ephesians 6. Now, if you've been following our Kids Online series, you'll have met our resident friendly Roman soldier who has shown us this breastplate, and then you may even have made your own breastplate. And it's designed to cover the heart and the vital organs. It's the centerpiece of our spiritual armor because it protects the center of our spiritual lives, the heart. And our breastplate is made of Jesus's resurrection power, righteousness, and protects our hearts from immorality. This is what makes us ready to be filled with God. We're not righteous by our own efforts. We're not saved by our own efforts. And the more we understand this, the more room in us there is for truth, and truth sets us free. We need God to fill us in order to be righteous. And that's the promise at the end of this verse that we're looking at today. Blessed are those who are hungry for righteousness, for they will be filled. For they will be filled. And the interesting thing I found whilst looking at the Beatitudes is that the promise section of each verse, or the rewards, however you want to word it, is often just as countercultural as the action part. These promises being given, especially to me and you in the modern world, are not really as incentivizing as they may have been in modern culture when they were first spoken. We live in a fast-paced world and we can't escape that. I mean, look at us now, I'm talking to a camera in an empty room. Instant gratification is a phrase that I'm sure we've all heard. It's something that we access through likes, through comments, fast food, streaming platforms. You can get whatever you want whenever you want it, and they help you pretend to fill a need that... I'm sorry, I've lost my place now. They pretend to fill a need for you for a while, but the thing that makes them successful and addictive is the speed at which they do that for you. So it takes me no time at all to find a week or two's worth of entertainment. I could just log into Netflix, scroll for a minute and click the first thing that catches my eye. If there's something I need to know, Google can answer it in a couple of clicks. I don't need to read a book or work too hard to find out. I can just Google it as long as I've got a connection. And I can make myself feel appreciated or important by posting a nice photo that I know will get a lot of likes. Equally, that one can go both ways and you can make yourself vulnerable to a lot of heartache, but that is not for today. So we have needs, we have hungers and thirsts, we have innate desires, and we have, as a race, created super fast ways to meet them. Efficiency, productivity, gratification run our world, but that, I would suggest, is not kingdom living, or at least it's not a kingdom in which God is the king. But these promises, like the one to be filled, isn't always an instant result. By no means am I saying now that it can't be, because I will not put God in a box if I can help it. But it's not of this world, and faith is often found in the waiting. God isn't an instant gratifier because he's in you, he's for you, for the long haul. He's in it for the long term. It's eternity long, it's a journey. A lot of what our vision actually of and church development is based in is this simplicity of hunger for God, to see more of God reflected in our world, to see more of him in our communities, to do what he's calling us to do for the benefit of those who come after us. One of the keynotes I heard whilst listening to David's message last week was about creating space for next generation leaders, for them to have an environment in which they are safe and secure to learn and to journey with God in a way that's going to see them grow beyond the potential that they ever thought they had. To see God's colours bursting out of our lives into the communities that we live in, that we serve in, and that we live in. So hunger is a driving force that drives us towards him, and nothing else matters. To be closer to him, to be filled by him, is what we're going after. If this is a message that's stirring you in any way or has touched a place in your heart, then I'd love to hear from you. We'd love to hear from you as a church. We'd love to connect with you and journey with you through that, talk to you a little bit more about who Jesus is and what he can do. So just contact us in any way you feel comfortable with, and we'll love to talk to you. So before I finish talking about the hunger and the passion for righteousness, for that drive that takes us to the next level of God relationship, I'd like to end in prayer, specifically a prayer John G. Lake called the most dangerous prayer we can, powerful prayer, sorry, we can pray as Christians, which is, God, make me hungry for you. So Lord, make us hungry for you this morning, whatever that looks like, whatever that feels like for these people this morning or whenever they're here. Whatever we have to let go of, Lord, lead us to those places and make us hungry for you. Make us bold enough to respond to that burning hunger that's within us. And if you're feeling something right now at home, I just want to encourage you to actually make a movement. So if you're sat down, stand up. If you stood up, put your arms out. Just make a physical change as an indication to God that this is something I'm responding to. I want more of that hunger. I want more of that passion in my life. So Lord, just come and fill your people in unimaginable ways right now. Fill them with inspiration. Fill them with blueprints for your church. Fill them with downloads of your thoughts. Fill them with dreams for your kingdom. Fill them with prophecies. Fill them with purpose, Lord. Fill them with you. You should fill them with that hunger. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
So thank you, Matt, for an amazing talk. It's so good, isn't it, to be reminded that Jesus knows us all personally. He knows exactly what we need, and he can meet with us. He speaks our language. So wherever you're at today, whatever is going on in your world, you can know that Jesus knows all about it, and he cares about it, and he cares about you. So I want to encourage us again, as we go into our week, to remember to set your internal atmosphere, calibrate your heart, and expect God to come and meet with you in your circumstances and situations. Read the word, get into the word, declare the promises of God. So beautiful. Be merciful and kind to yourself. Be your own best friend. Take time to worship through the week in a stance of rest and peace. And be thankful. Cultivate thankfulness in your heart. And let your expectancy for God be activated this week. We're going to finish with a time to worship again. And we just want to say thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you are here. You are here with each one of us, that you know us personally, and you care about everything that is going on in our world. And we just declare our expectancy in your goodness, in your kingdom, in your love and your grace. Amen.
Majesty. kitchen to marvelous forwards to wonderful for comprehension like nothing ever seen.
Thank you for joining with us today in this online service. We are so thrilled that you were able to be here with us. We would like to warmly invite you to join our Zoom lounge, which is immediately after this service. And the link is?
Just need to email us at info@cromerchurchbirmingham.com and we can get you connected. It's a great informal time for communion, chat, a little bit of fellowship, a little bit of get to know you introduction. So if you can, just be in touch. We'd love to get you connected.
Absolutely.
Also need to let you know that next Sunday, one of our nominated charities is Open Doors. And we're just creating some new prayer opportunities for people to connect, understand more about the work of Open Doors. So if you'd like to be a part of that, again, email us and we can give you a Zoom link for a prayer time we're having next Sunday evening at 7 o'clock. That's hosted by Jane Campion-Hoy is our local representative for Open Doors. She's been in recent services just sharing some of the vision. It's a fantastic charity, one that we're proud to support, and we'd love you to be a part Absolutely. Of partnering with that.
And just to remind you that we will be posting out to you our newsletter introducing Cromer Church Birmingham. And if you would like one of these and you're not on our mailing list, please get in touch with us and we will post that out to you.
Yeah, you can do that on our social media too. Just drop us a message Absolutely. And we can get that out to you. So look forward to seeing you next week.
Nothing compares. close.